I'm Michelle Kraft, and I'm a retired professor of art at Lubbock Christian University. My current role with LCU is teaching art history part-time, which I love. I'm a bit of an art history geek. And I also work with the study abroad program as the on-site director in Avila, Spain. And I want to thank the Naperville Church of Christ for inviting me to participate in this online series. And I think it's going to be really fun. And so thank you for joining me for this. Now, the question that I was given was, does the painting of the Last Supper actually look like the Last Supper that is in the Bible? And I think a lot of us, when we think of the Last Supper, we think of Leonardo da Vinci's painting, the Last Supper. Perhaps it is the most famous Last Supper painting of all. And so this is certainly the one I'm going to address as we think about that. But it's also interesting to consider the context of this painting. And the context in which Leonardo da Vinci painted this is during the time of the Italian Renaissance, the High Renaissance, and also for within a very specific setting. This painting is painted inside a dining hall at a monastery, Santa Maria delle Grazie in Milan, Italy. And so when you think about that, it is sort of interesting that there would be a feast painting inside this dining hall so that anytime the brothers at the monastery got together and dined together, it was in the presence of this painting. And you can see that even at one point in its history, someone felt there really must be a door right here. And so they cut a door into the bottom of Leonardo da Vinci's painting, which is kind of crazy in a way, if you think about it. So this is the painting that we will look at in just a moment as we consider that question of how truthful visually is the painting to perhaps what the Last Supper might have looked like in the Bible had we been present there. But it may interest you to know that da Vinci's painting, while the most famous certainly, is not the only Last Supper painting that was ever done. In fact, this is a very popular theme throughout art history. And so we see it show up quite a bit in the Middle Ages and during the Renaissance earlier than da Vinci, and certainly after him as well. And so I'm showing you just a couple of examples of those. This is a painting that predates da Vinci's painting. This is by a different artist named Andrea del Castagno. And it was not the usual thing to paint Judas on the same side as the table as Leonardo da Vinci did. You'll notice in Del Castagno's painting, Judas is painted on the total opposite side of the table as every other disciple. And this is to signify this physical separation, is to signify his spiritual separation from the group. And so this is the way that he typically appeared in Last Supper paintings during that time period. Da Vinci sort of changed things up a little bit by putting him on the same side as the table as all the other apostles. This is another example of a Last Supper painting. This one is by Jacopo Tintoretto, another Italian artist, and this one is painted after Da Vinci's Last Supper. And you'll notice this one has some differences to it too. Look at how Tintoretto paints it at this diagonal so that it has a very dynamic, exciting kind of appearance. And it's not just Jesus and the 12 disciples that are present. There are servants present. We see a heavenly host swooping in. There's all kinds of activity and drama going on in this Last Supper painting. So it's certainly perhaps a different depiction than what we're used to seeing. But as we consider the Last Supper, it's interesting to maybe look at what the Last Supper is and to look at it in reference to what we see happening. What is that event commemorating? And there are some fascinating parallels between the Feast of Unleavened Bread or the Passover and that event in Exodus 12, when that meal, the institution of that meal was set up, and to look at some of the things happening between Christ and his disciples during the Last Supper as well. So I picked out three themes that I thought would be worthwhile to look at, and then we'll maybe take a look at Leonardo da Vinci's painting and see if these three themes show up in his painting and what may be different from what we know about the Last Supper when it was first set up and how the Last Supper is practiced even today. So in Exodus 12, the three themes I chose, by the way, are commemoration, community, and continuous remembrance. And in Exodus 12, in the Last Supper, as we look at this theme, this in Exodus 12 is where the Last Supper is instituted. It is where God tells Moses, gives directions, very specific directions for this meal, for how it is to be conducted. and for the why of it and what it's to mean to the people of Israel. So you can look to Exodus 12 for some of those instructions on the lamb and how the lamb was to be cooked and how old the lamb was supposed to be and how this meal was to be shared. For instance, they were supposed to partake of this meal with their coats kind of tucked into their belts as if they were about to leave, because that is really what happened during that Passover event. As a reminder, that very physical manifestation of how you eat this meal is a reminder of the why this meal occurred, that you were about, as the people of Israel, to flee from Egypt. So a couple of things. When we look at commemoration and this idea of commemorating a deliverance specifically, we see that the Lord tells his people, I will pass through Egypt and I will strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. So there is a commemoration of the deliverance of Israel and the role that blood plays in that. Even the feasting on a lamb is significant. And so we'll see that as we tie that idea to Jesus a little bit later. Also this idea of community. Community is sort of within this entire Passover thing. And so it says, tell the whole community of Israel to get together and to do this forevermore, that they will share a lamb. If the lamb is too large for a small household, then you need to get together with your neighbors, your nearest neighbors, and you need to share in this feast together. So this idea of community really comes through in this Passover and the directions given for the Passover too. And then there's also the idea of continuous remembrance. This is supposed to go on for all generations. And so we see that in Exodus 12:14, it says, this is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come, and you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance. And also in verse 17, it says, celebrate the feast of unleavened bread, which is the other name for the Passover, the continuous Passover feast, because it is on this very day that I brought you out in your divisions out of Egypt. Celebrate this day as a lasting ordinance for the generations to come. And so we see that even as far back as in the Old Testament, so that when Jesus gets together in the New Testament and celebrates this Passover meal with his disciples, we see some of these same ideas reflected, because Jesus is part of that continuous remembrance within that community of Israel of that deliverance that God provided. So for instance, when we look at Matthew 26, chapters 24 and 28, we see that same emphasis on commemoration and even blood and the role of blood in it. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him, Jesus says in Matthew. And he's tying what is about to happen to him to what was written about him by the Old Testament prophets. And he says, this blood is my covenant. My blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. There's the same idea of blood and deliverance that we see tied to the Passover idea. Likewise, there is this idea of community as well, where he says, go into the city to a certain man and tell him, the teacher says, my appointed time is near and I am going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house. And in Luke, when he says, when the hour came, Jesus and his disciples reclined together at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. So he is sharing this meal with his community of disciples. And we see that there. And then there's this idea, too, of continuous remembrance. When repeat the scriptures, do this in remembrance of me. And even Paul in 1 Corinthians 11:26 says to us, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so that same idea is even extended down to us, this notion of commemoration of our deliverance as Christians, this notion that we do it within our Christian community alongside our brothers and sisters, and that we are continually remembering this gift and this commemoration. So let's see how maybe some of these ideas apply to Leonardo da Vinci's painting, The Last Supper. So as we look at his painting, I just want to remind you that it was painted within that specific context. So a little bit more, some things that you may notice if you look very closely at the painting. Look at the bread that is spread on the table before them. This bread is definitely leavened bread. What does that mean? Leavening is what you put into bread to make it rise, to give it loft and air. So for instance, our common leavenings that we use are yeast, and also we use baking powder when we make cakes and biscuits and things like that. So those are examples of leavening. Without those, you would have a very flat piece of bread. This whole feast, though, is called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And so we see that maybe there is a little bit of a difference between the Passover that Jesus would have shared with his disciples and what we see in this Italian painting from the 1400s. Other things to look at are who is seated at the table and how are they seated. So this is the point in the story, the Bible story, where Jesus has just said to his disciples, one of you will betray me. And you'll notice that he sits there very calmly. He's the focus of our attention. He's right there in the center. Meanwhile, all of his disciples have broken up into groupings of threes, and they're discussing. It's like Jesus dropped a bomb in the dinner, and they're discussing together who has, and you see them gesturing. Is it you? Is it me? And so they're all kind of sharing together in these discussion groups. But what's interesting is how these groups are separated into threes. Three is a number symbolizing completion, symbolizing wholeness. And so even as Da Vinci has arranged these apostles in groupings of threes, we sort of see that idea of fulfillment carried through the painting. And even of the Godhead, the Son and the Holy Spirit and the Father, all kind of combined there within that symbolic use of threes. Also, take a look at how Da Vinci composed this painting, because we'll see that all of these receding lines in this linear perspective that he uses just kind of point us straight to Jesus. If you look at how those lines recede into space, everything takes our eye to Jesus there at the center. Even the light surrounding his head kind of puts him in a position that's different maybe than some of the other apostles. It makes him sort of stand out among all the group there. Also, other things that we'll see that are references or things that are kind of specific to the Renaissance or things that are originated in the Renaissance. One of the ideas behind the Renaissance is this idea of humanism. And we see humanist philosophical thought showing up in this painting. Humanism basically can be summed up in the phrase, man, humankind, is the measure of all things. And it celebrates human endeavor and human achievement. And these ideas certainly influenced Leonardo da Vinci when he was painting his Last Supper painting during his period, during his time. So there are many ways in which this painting represents the context of the thought and the type of thinking that went on during da Vinci's time. A couple of notable ways that this shows up is, for instance, in the size of all of the people. They are sized the regular way that we would expect people to be sized. And what the reason I point that out is because in medieval painting and even in very ancient artworks, we see that the most significant figure, the most important person in the painting is usually larger and everyone else is smaller. And here, Da Vinci has put everyone on the same plane in terms of the realistic sizing of them. And in this way, he is pointing, not necessarily emphasizing Christ's deity, but emphasizing his humanity. He is the same size as all of the other men in the painting. Another thing that we often see in paintings of religious figures that we expect to see and have expected to see all through the Middle Ages, but we don't see it here, is the use of halos. Normally, that is what is a distinguishing feature of the saints and other holy figures in the work, including Jesus, and we don't see the use of halos here. So again, Da Vinci in this way is emphasizing Christ's humanity and even the humanity of the different apostles that we see present here. So those are some things where we see this humanist influence, but interestingly, he does sort of, Da Vinci alludes to a halo in Christ. It's difficult to make out, but there is an arch over the window above Christ's head, and then the light coming from the window as it surrounds his head sort of hinted a halo without actually going through and painting a golden halo around Christ or any of the other figures in the paintings. So those were some of those humanistic influences that we see there. Another thing that's sort of interesting just to note as a sidebar, I suppose, is this figure right here, which is supposed to be the Apostle John. He's the youngest of the apostles. He was among the four that were Christ's inner circle of friends that he and had a special friendship with Christ. And he appears to be very young here. But some people, some critics and conspiracy theorists have suggested that this is not Christ, not John, that this is actually a woman and it is Mary Magdalene. And they would then the question would be, well, why are there 12 people here? And they would say, well, Judas has already left, and this is Mary Magdalene in this place. And one of the primary reasons why that idea just doesn't work is because the text does not mention the presence of Mary Magdalene at the Last Supper. In fact, all of the texts that discuss the Last Supper in the Bible do not include Mary Magdalene as having been present during that time. Another thing that's sort of interesting in looking at the context of this painting is just the banqueting scene itself. If you look at the apostles and Jesus, they're all seated at a table, but of course in the ancient world, banqueting occurred reclining, and this holds up with the text too. The fact that Luke describes Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table, and then also in John, how it talks about John leans his head back up against Jesus to ask him, who is it who is going to betray them? And that's because they were reclining together at a banquet, sort of like this right here. And so that's another thing that's quite a bit of a difference too. And these, by the way, are examples from the Greco-Roman world, and which would have been the period in which the Last Supper was taking place. And so we see in these carvings and in these paintings that banqueting took place in a reclined situation. So that's another thing that we see there. So in taking a look really at Da Vinci's painting of the Last Supper, we see that there are some interesting things about it in the way that it attends to the three themes that I've picked out. This idea of deliverance, this idea of Christ's blood being shed for his people that we see borne out in the glasses of wine and the bread on the table, his body and his blood given. So we see that kind of tied to the Passover and the actual Last Supper. We certainly see he is with his community of his closest friends that he eagerly desired to share this meal with. And we see that showing up in Da Vinci's painting too. And then we also see this idea of continuous remembrance. The fact that it's even in a dining hall of a monastery, because these monks as they're eating are to remember too this meal and this communion with each other. The word communion comes from community. And so I think it is significant that Christ chose a meal because we love to get together and eat with our families and our friends and bond over those food experiences. So it's interesting that he chose a meal and that he looked forward to this meal as a last gesture with the entire body of his disciples together. But then also we see that there are certain small ways in which the painting sort of maybe doesn't reflect the actuality of what happened at the Last Supper, that reflect perhaps the time period in which the piece was created, such as the Mary Magdalene example too, some things that are kind of far out ideas sometimes associated with this, which shows us the importance of looking to the text. In history, and that includes art history and literature, and certainly as Christians, we look to the text to see the meaning and the interpretation of the meaning that makes the most sense is the one that has the most evidences that line up behind it. And we have this evidence of scripture that talks to us about who was present at this Last Supper, who were the important figures there with Christ and the meaning behind this meal. And so that's true of other aspects of study, including Christian study and Christian thought, and that we are so fortunate to have so many texts in the Gospels and in Corinthians and other places that tell us about this and that are enduring even until this time. So certainly Da Vinci's painting is a reflection of his period, but also a reflection of some of these enduring and important Christian ideas too. And this Last Supper painting is so famous and shows up all the time in parody and satire, and you might be able to think of some examples of that as well. And one that has emerged most recently out of this pandemic is this example of what the Last Supper could look like during a pandemic. If you've been to classes and you have been to meetings on different platforms, video platforms, this format may look pretty familiar to you, but it is, again, a testimony to the endurance of this theme, especially of the Last Supper and this communion that we have together as Christians but also to Da Vinci's painting. And so thank you so much for joining me, and I hope you enjoyed our discussion, and maybe it gives you some things to think about and to talk about.